May I request the session panelists to please take your seats on the dais. We'll start with our session chair and moderator, Shri Sunil Joshi ji, head of business development, Sileaf Technologies. I invite Mr. Gurpreet Singh, VP Engineering and Projects from Gensol. Mr. Jayachandra, he is business head of Rooftop Solar at Sterling and Wilson. Mr. Pradeep Srikanthan, Vice President, Redington. Mr. Anil Misra, National Sales and Marketing Manager of Sonali Solar. Mr. Ankur from UR Energy India Private Limited. Mr. Raghuram from Ujas. Let's welcome our panelists with a big round of applause. So basically, it is more oriented about manufacturing, technology, EPC, operation and maintenance, and more or basically on the technology side. Like the last session, the previous lunch session was more focusing on project development and financing and investments and RESCO models and all. So we are happy to have such a diverse panel. Gentleman from Gensol, who is one of the biggest consultants in solar. Sterling Wilson is definitely the most leading company in solar EPCs. So Mr. Jayachandra will give us a good perspective about what Sterling is doing on rooftops. Redington, definitely as a famous company who is into distribution of Apple products, is contributing a lot more to the overall supply chain and the logistics of the solar power hardware. And we have Mr. Sunil Joshi from Sileaf. He has various technologies on offer from Sileaf and Relyon Group. And then we have domestic manufacturers represented by Sonali Solar, Mr. Anil Misra, local big EPC companies, UR Energy represented by Mr. Ankur, and Ujas definitely has been at the front runner in solar park development or EPC or O&M or even rooftops for that matter now. So let's welcome our session panelists, and the format will be same, like around 7-8 minutes to 10 minutes of independent speech or presentation, and in the end, as the time permits, then we can have a small panel discussion moderated by our session chair and moderator, Shri Sunil Joshi ji, and we'll try to keep room for a few questions to keep it interactive. Thank you very much. Over to Sunil Joshi sir to start the session. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure and honor to have this responsibility to chair and moderate this session. At the same time, it seems to be given a big responsibility after serving such a delicious lunch. It's my and all the panelists' responsibility to ensure that we keep this post-lunch session as active and as interactive as the earlier ones. We'll try our best. To start with, I would like to invite, as Mr. Anand had just briefed, in view of maintaining a timing, we would have each of the panelists having 8 minutes for presentation, and then we would have question answers at the last after all the presentations. So to start with, I would like to invite Mr. Gurpreet Singh, Vice President for Gensol.
It's an honor standing here in front of the fraternity and quite eminent panelists along with me. So today I represent Gensol Group, and we are into one of the important fields which is gaining importance lately, that is O&M, operation and maintenance of the solar projects. So I'll share our insights into that. So this is how the flow is going to be. We are going to discuss a little bit on how the soiling losses and cleaning costs, which are directly linked, and they take the center stage when we ever discuss O&M of a solar project. I'll share a quick case study with you how this correlation has been established. What are the important assumptions which you have to keep in mind, and what are the pitfalls that we should avoid while planning the O&M for our projects? Monitoring and corrective maintenance is of prime importance when we talk of uptimes and the looking at the tariffs, how they are falling today. Uptime is of utmost importance. So we'll discuss about that also. other considerations, small bits and pieces which contribute to the cost of O&M and eventually built up to 10 to 15%, but generally have a tendency to be ignored while planning for that, we'll look into it. And at the end, we'll try to translate everything into rupees and look how the things convert into the returns. Okay, so as you know that the perception that we have in the Indian markets, at least 1 year back, was that O&M is all about cleaning of the panels, but it's not that. But yes, that said, it takes 30% of the cost and effort in maintaining a plant. So that's a broad breakup that we have shown that how O&M cost can be broken down. How we compare the cleaning cycles. Cleaning cycle is something which is the prime metric, the yardstick that people use while signing their O&M contracts. Generally, the thumb rule is that people tend to use 24 cleaning cycles. That's roughly two cycles a month. Or if you factor in the rainy months, then some months one cycle and the worst months three cycles. But that's not the case. There is actually no thumb rule. It depends on the project. It depends on the location. It depends on your returns because cleaning is a 30% cost. So how do you arrive at that? So how we try to do is we benchmark in a single plant when we take over. We establish a reference string, and that reference string is cleaned every day. And then the strings on the rest of the plant is compared against that. What it helps is during the design of the plant, generally you assume a soiling loss, let's say 1.5%, 2%, 2.5%. How is that actually happening on the ground? How do you make your teams accountable? So this referencing and benchmark method happens. We did that in Punjab and where one module was cleaned on day zero, and for 80 days this was compared, and the variation was 2.5%. So that is how the soiling loss at that plant was established. Okay, now coming on the cost, how at a design stage of a project, a major decision that design teams today face is that what kind of cleaning system we have to assume. Should it be robotic? Should it be conventional cleaning with a tractor and water coming in? Do you want to invest in a pipeline infrastructure? Now, that's also a very scientific method of doing that. We really look what are the savings. Savings are converted from your tariff and the soiling loss, which is reduced from your generation. And based on that, we see what is the cost of cleaning. This red curve which you're seeing is the cost of cleaning here, where you're bringing in a tractor and a water tanker and of course hiring a labor and then cleaning it. Then when you compare that with the blue thing, which is your profit lost because of soiling, you'll get an intersection point. You'll get an intersection point which gives you what is the optimum cleaning cycle that you should have. If you clean more than that, you're losing money. If you clean less than that, you're losing profit. Okay, so in this case, when we were doing with a tractor and a cleaning cycle, it was coming to almost touching every month, means a month cleaning. If you see the second case where a pipeline was there, now if we would have gone by a thumb rule of two cycles per month with a pipeline system, you have invested a little bit more in that. Here you can see that it has exceeded 1 month. It is roughly around 40 days. Right. So the thing is that you have to have a scientific approach towards it, that what kind of mechanism you want to adopt, what is the scale of your plant, factor it a little bit of local cost during your due diligence, and arrive at a scientific conclusion for your project. The other assumptions which impact soiling and cleaning is what is the rainfall frequency. If your rainfall frequency is high, your cleaning cost will be low because your cycles will be low. Tilt angle, higher tilt angle, the tendency of dust sticking to the panels is lesser, right? So if you are taking a higher tilt, don't assume thumb rule cycles. You have some savings to do there. Tariff per kilowatt, right now, for example, we are maintaining the oldest plants and tariffs. There are 15, 9 rupees, 10 rupees. At that plant, it makes all the sense to even clean it every week. So you have to consciously check how that cycle is arrived upon. Speed of cleaning. Soiling losses, direct correlation, robotics have taken a center stage today. A lot of big developers are experimenting. There are successful operating plants on the ground. But once again, it is directly correlated to your tariff and the soiling loss of that area. Generation limited by inverters capacity. Sometimes what happens, plants recently being designed are touching 40% overloading. At that point, there is a certain cutoff that inverter will bring in, what in technical terms we call as clipping losses. So are you cleaning the modules when they are actually clipped? The power is clipped during the peak time of the day. a very rational analysis with that is required while designing your cleaning cycles. And of course, if you have experimental soiling data from the plant, like we told, we were benchmarking a string, factor that in into your model, and then you can have more realistic assumptions. Okay, talking a little bit of monitoring and corrective maintenance, when we talk of uptime of a system, once again, we have a blanket limit. Okay, one time up, 1% uptime we want. When you are negotiating a contract with the O&M guy, or even if you have your in-house teams, uptime is not similar with all the equipment. I'll tell you example why. The blue bar which you see is the energy lost, and the orange bar is the percentage of events. If we say that, okay, there are 10 events which have happened in a solar project, that is a percentage. So which component is more prone to get a downtime? That component deserves more attention. For example, inverters. Energy loss will be very high, but the chances, the events occurring in that with today's inverter technology are little lesser. DC side loss will be high because it's on the generation side, but events occurring are more because your spread in the ground is more. The speed of execution today, when we talk of, generally ground faults are happening on the DC side, so it deserves more attention. Interesting case of grid. For example, your events of the grid might be very high. When you analyze the fault log of your inverter, you might see out of frequency, grid downtime and all that, but that is generally momentarily. For example, even if a grid goes for 10 seconds, your inverter will boot and reboot and come into that. So the loss, the impact on that is lower. So the crux is that you have to treat each component separately and talk about uptime for each componental levels and not at a plant level. The industry standard term, two terms, which is MTBF, MTTR, that is mean time between failures and mean time to repair. As very rightly said here, that MTBF is highly dependent on the PV plant quality. It depends on your design, what kind of systems have you kept, have you used conduits, are your conduits sealed, have you used cable trays properly, or just laid the cables. So it is highly dependent on the design. Mean time to repair is how your spare strategy you have figured out while ordering your equipment. So spares is also one of the biggest cost. So spare strategies highly impact your MTTR. Okay, so this is the rate of failure, and we see if we talk of a complete equipment cycle, it is divided into three periods: early failure period, normal operating, and a wear out period. And the faults during wear out period is what you actually have to predict. This once again varies from equipment to equipment, so it's very important while figuring out your O&M strategy, you figure out what are the wear out cycle of your breaker, cycle of your switch gears, cycle of your switchyard equipments. Okay, other considerations, when we talk of PR and uptime guarantee, these considerations you have to keep in mind whether you are talking O&M within your company, within your teams, or you are appointing an O&M contractor. So any contractor, if he does generally have a tendency to do a due diligence of your plant, and if your plant is good, they will be ready to give you even PR guarantee and guaranteed uptime, which takes away a lot of risk today. Importance of handover. You all have been in the same industry, and every day you are seeing news that some other equity partner or some other banker is being appointed to, and assets are changing hands every day. So handover documentation plays a lot of role in that. If your drawings, as-built, and everything is in place, it adds intangible value to your asset, which trickles down during the ultimate deal. Simplest example of transportation, how the O&M costing is done. For example, you're putting a four guys team at O&M site. We as O&M contractors, if we don't have a place to stay in the plant, we'll be renting vehicles, we'll be renting houses. While during the time of building the plant, that extra room might cost you just 75,000 to 1 lakh rupees. But to us, it costs 10% of the O&M cost. So it has to be, when we do the pricing, when we do the initial budgeting of a project, generally O&M costs are not taken into factor. The IRRs and the financial models are run based on the capex costs. So this precise analysis helps you with that. Security, we have. Security is another issue, and that is one of the tools used by most of the developers to provide local employment, but there have been cases where security guards have been colluding with the local population, and there have been cases of thefts. So we have to look at more robust surveillance systems, and if detailed analysis done between electronic fencing and compared to your normal chain link or concrete one, fencing, electronic fencing sometimes come out to be cheaper if you look at the size of the project. Tools, PPE and EHS. Now, safety is one big consideration, and if you see a lot of assets, a lot of foreign companies are coming and they follow their global standards. In that case, your EHS cost really goes high in O&M, where your compliance standards are much, much stringent and with respect to global levels. That is a factor you have to keep while ascertaining your O&M costs. Plant health diagnosis, as I told you, that it's very important to keep your health checkup assignment. You can appoint an agency for that. While appointing your O&M contractor, he will generally do that. But even if it's not there, we recommend once a year. Spares and consumable 100%, it's second biggest cost in an O&M project. 30% of the O&M cost can go into it. And consumables also, we tend to ignore the small items, silica gel, grease, paints, everything, but these also factor in. So then in nutshell, what we are trying to say is that how much depth you go into breaking down your O&M cost really plays a role, and small things do add up at the end. And while giving out the contract, do factor that in and ask your contractor or question your teams internally. To put everything to perspective, when we talk of returns, when you're doing your financial modeling, you are worried about 0.5%, 1% increase in the IRRs. But if you factor in all these things, 1.48%, we have practically observed increase in IRR if you're following healthy O&M practices. So this is what I have to share with you. And I highly recommend that do have a strategy, do have a solid strategy and analysis, and do that scientifically about O&M of your projects. Thank you.
That was a great presentation, Mr. Singh. It was very helpful inputs. Thank you for that. May I invite Mr. Jayachandra from Sterling Wilson for the next presentation.
No, I don't have a presentation.
Request to all the panelists, just to maintain the timing, please maintain your timely limit and allow me to remind you when we are about to finish your time. Thank you.
Yeah, I think your reminder will help. I think this you can close. No, I don't have a presentation.
Okay, just a speech.
Yeah. Good afternoon, gentlemen and ladies also. Thank you for the opportunity, dear AQ team. I represent Sterling and Wilson, who is known for utility scale projects on a larger picture of solar, having around more than a gigawatt of portfolio in the utility scale. But still, on the rooftop segment, we are putting our small steps, which has just started 2 years back, a year back, and in the second year of operations. The challenges, I mean, I would like to take up some of the issues on the challenges of EPC, because I have to talk on EPC. O&M, I think our friend has given a very fantastic picture of O&M and optimizing the O&M and the cost. How many of you are pure EPC people? 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, I think very less people share my concerns, because I think you may be undergoing. Rest others, I think, maybe in the manufacturing or the investment segment, looking EPC as the people who are making money out of their business. Really, I think we are undergoing a lot of challenges. EPC as such is a very, very challenging activity, which starts from the scale of operation. When we say EPC, EPC has a very big market in the solar segment. given that particularly in the rooftop segment, given that the target of the country and all, I mean, all of us know about that. I don't want to repeat about our 40 megawatt thinking and then ultimately Marcom or Solar Edge predicting that I think we may end up in around 10 to 12 gigawatt of installation at the end, I think gigawatt of installation by 2022. That's the market. So we have a huge market in front of us as a EPC operator. But where is it seen and how is it done? That's the question. That is where we are every day trying to address those issues. The challenge starts from the business model itself, whether the EPC is coming to you through an IPP model or a CAPEX model, an OPEX or a CAPEX model. The moment the project is defined as an OPEX model, it will have its own dimensions, and the moment it is defined as a CAPEX model or owner investing it, that has a different dimension altogether, right from the composition of the project and the completion of the project and delivering the end results. So that is the first challenge, which starts from the business model. Then comes the regulatory challenges, where we have to undergo a lot of regulatory understanding first and then compliance next. So each state, or we being operating across India, I think we come across almost different rules, regulations, easiness, difficulty levels, all the things we face. There are certain states which are very easy, certain states which is very difficult to crack. So that is another challenge where we have to face the regulatory. That regulatory, right from the capacity identification and the capacity finalization for that, and the evacuation permissions, and finally closing the projects with all the permits in hand to the end customer, or whether he is an investor or whether it's a CAPEX. Then comes the design challenges. Rooftop is very easy to say. A roof is there and people have to put some panels over that. Rooftop challenges are the design challenges starts from, again, scale of the project. If it is a residential, the challenges are different. If it is a commercial building, the challenges are different. And for the industrial buildings, it's again different. Right from the roof details, the stability, the type of roof and the type of orientation it has, the inclination or the azimuth, which is required to optimize the power generation and also the optimize the costing. So that is on the throws a big picture on how you select the structures and end up in giving a very good capacity, because the capacity identification, the normally when we go to market, I think the first thing which we say is that your competitor has given 600 kilowatt design where you are coming up with 500. That means, have you optimized your capacity when you offer? So the capacity optimization, and then if it is a developer project, then the generation optimization, because developer will be looking at how maximum within the given roof which you can develop and which you can generate and give it. So that is the second part. And the third thing and the most important thing will be the cost challenges, because you have to deliver a project within certain cost which you have agreed, or you have to be competitive. If it is in the bidding stage, to be very competitive, what are all the components which you consider, and what level of components, what level of quality, what level of scale which you can buy and then deliver. That is the cost challenge. And in case if there is a consultant or if any other media involved in between, then the specifications, then the compliance, then the inspections. There are several other factors which will add on to the design cost and then give you a cost challenge during the design. Then comes the evacuation point. Where are you evacuating? How far it is? What kind of cable? What is the voltage drop you are trying to maintain? What is the voltage drop required to be maintained as per norms? Or what else you can compromise over there? How do you take the cables, the associated parts like trenches or the cable trays? which all add to more complication as well as the cost. But the from the beginning, you have a challenge to optimize both of them. So that is another this thing. And the last point in the evacuation is again the customer infrastructure support, which will to get the evacuation done, the DG synchronization in case they have a DG, and the capacity matching of the DG, whether your rooftop solar capacity versus the existing DG capacity, will they really match for a successful synchronization, or whether you have to make some avoidance, and the harmonics and power factor, I mean, these are other electrical factors which you have to, because mostly when the project is conceived or when it starts, these things will not come into discussion also in many cases. Only when it is getting commissioned and the handing over, I think when he say the handing over documentation, then all these things starts coming, because most of the maintenance team by that time would have become most intelligent people of the customer side, and then start giving you all the jitters in the commissioning part. So that is another challenge. Then comes the procurement challenges. When you operate when you are operating a plant or a system, I mean, what big scale you are. One advantage which Sterling Wilson has or perceived to be having is the scale of operations. I mean, we buy a lot of materials, being our MEP business as well as the utility solar business. Then we have some advantage of the vendor base as well as the capacity of buying. But for most of the other EPC operators, I think that may not be the case, because we have to buy on case-to-case basis, where the buying of small length cables or the delivering it and the transportation of the small lengths or small capacity, this thing will definitely put a pressure on your transportation and the freight costs, as well as the availability and the timely availability more than anything. So these are some of the challenges on the supply chain. But looking at the larger picture, when we have scale to deliver, then a kind of 10 gigawatt, whether we have in our country, I mean, the capacity to deliver such kind of equipments in a short time, or in 3 years or 3.5 years, what we are looking at. So that is the manufacturing base or the supply chain challenge also will start appearing. Construction, I don't think I need to elaborate, because my time is also coming up. The infrastructure, it starts from access to the roof. I mean, we call it a rooftop. The moment the installation team visits site, the first trouble will be to access the roof. How to access the roof safely and also along with all the materials. So that is another challenge. And availability of resources, I think the resource crunch is going to kill all of us, because the trained resources who can safely and quality delivery of the project at the end of the day is going to be a dearth if we consider 10 gigawatt as in next 3 weeks, 3 years, which the industry has to deliver. And the permissions I discussed. Then, of course, O&M is another this thing which he has already covered. So getting into these challenges, the industry is looking lucrative. Industry is having a lot of job in hand. The most important thing an EPC operator has to develop, which I see right now, is the IPP projects are coming up in large scale under the government segment, where that is where the capacity is going to be built. Railways have come up with 100 megawatt, and SECI is coming out with 500 and 1 gigawatt. Where developers are there, we saw in the first session, there are a lot of developers who are ready to invest and then put money. But how do you, as an EPC operator, how do you develop an ecosystem for this large scale? It is like a carpet bombing. I think when you say 100 megawatt of railway platforms, I mean, across all the railway stations will come to accumulate that. But how do you do that in a time frame where you deliver, and then people and quality design? So this is the ecosystem which the industry or the developers are looking, which is a challenge. I think Sterling and Wilson at our end, we are working out some strategies to address this issue, so that we can feed IPP operators with a commendable resource and ecosystem where they can depend on us to get such deliveries. With this, I thank you once again for your patience hearing.